all. My name is Innus. I work with Deshpande Foundation since 5 years. So I would like to talk about Deshpande Foundation agriculture program. So our model is like cost sharing model. We implement program called Vrutti, which helps farmers to construct farm ponds. So we started in 2014, and 2014 we constructed 15 farm ponds, taking one machine from like Tata, and they used to do it. They said that DF can try. So, and also our one of partners, we used to fund him, and he did 10 ponds, and then next year he said, I want to do 15. So then we think, okay, let's we need to go for implementation. Earlier we used to only support financially and mentorship. So till today, like we constructed 750 farm pond, is a bigger 100 by 112 feet. Each farm pond can irrigate 5 acres of land. So like major cost saving is like capex foundation done and all operational cost taken care by farmer. So if we go on cost, like if government want to do this 750 farm pond, so they need 8 crore of rupees. We have done it within 2.5 CR, and all money kept in case from farmers. So that's the unique. Otherwise, farmer doing it, they know what is the farm pond. So why, like first year we have able to get 16, and then last year 400. What are the 4-5 things which make it to deliver? So first thing is cost. So we reduce the cost like 50%. If farmer wants farm pond 100 by 112, so if market is cost is 1 lakh, so we have reduced it like 35,000 and farmer paid for it. Second thing is like we are very fast delivery. If farmer approach us within 3 days, we will deliver it. And then like team. So we have very good team and the local community involvement. So that's why it's like more become fast. And also it's like quality. Our quality is little higher. So it's make a lot of difference. So now like we had impact study. So one farm pond enabled to have 50,000 to 80,000 incrementally per acre incremental income because of the farm pond. So I think this is the huge, and this year we will be going to double it. Whatever we have done last 3 years, so we want to do it within this 6 months, like January to June. So thank you very much for opportunity. So this is the like we are doing.
Great. So I think just to sum up, because we will talk later when you want to ask questions, it may be helpful. One is the cost efficiency you brought, so it's 50% cost reduction. Second is 3 days back, the farm pond is ready, so the farmers can quickly opt for it. And usage quality is better than what others are. So these are your secrets, and we want to get into the position to triple what we have. And also, I think the most important thing we know, lesson for our NGO, most of us in the NGO sector, is that you are making farmers to pay for.
Yes.
Without 100%.
Or operational cost is paid for.
Okay. So it's an economic model. So thank you.
Namaste. So in India, actually, the agriculture is a main economic activity. But India is dominated by small and marginal farmers. Every day, the agriculture land is being fragmented or it's dividing. And the water is a major source to enhance or to ensure the food security of the nation. Maximum forest area has been submerged due to the dams and all. If we receive good rainfall, this plain land, northern part of the Karnataka will that river will flow, otherwise river will be dried up. In this situation, big programs of the government is most probably it is hampering to the sustainability. The water is showing the climate change effect. somewhere we are seeing the drought and somewhere we are seeing the floods. This is the situation. Water is showing us climate is changing, atmosphere situation is differing like that. So we are the main, our human activities is the main causes for increase in greenhouse gases in the atmosphere. So in this context, so we are providing and we are thinking about micro level planning, how natural resources can be sustainable usage of natural resources, especially water. Government is claiming that the protection and sustainability of the natural resources is the duty of the government. That's why the people of the community or the individual farmers are neglecting. If they want water, just they will go to the tahsildar or some government officials or MLAs and they ask for the water. If the soil erosion will happen, that's also a duty of government to control the soil erosion. This is the thinking the people are having. When last 4-5 years back, when we started construction of farm ponds, people were showing some unusable land or some if we construct a farm pond in that land, it was no use for that. So such kind of land they were showing to construct farm ponds, because we were doing that farm ponds with grant support and without taking any money from the farmers. Slowly we started asking money from the farmer, then they were thinking where to construct the farm pond, what's the use of that pond to be, all these things. That thinking process has improved. So our staff, this he was telling about retaining the staff in this fee structure, or if we are some person in our staff, we advise him to ask some money from the beneficiary, he will refuse actually. Sometime he may go out to search another job. In this situation, now we are getting around 80-90% of the total construction as well as our staff salary, everything from the farmers. Initially we were hiring machines from the outsiders or vendors, but now our team has equipped to maintain our own Hitachi machines, our own lorries, maintenance, transportation, everything, that value chain, that machine repair and procurement of design and transportation, everything will be managed by our organization. Now the value chain has become shorter like this. So now we are able to reduce the cost of construction of farm pond. That's why now the farmer are paying almost 100% of the construction cost in almost all the villages. This is the situation, and we are also thinking about tank plus activities. Once we construct tank, so now the farmers are growing another crop, we are advising which crop is better. Now we are practicing SRI in summer, with short with less quantity of water we can grow more crop through adoption of system of rice intensification method. And few farmers are growing vegetables, and some evaporation will be happening in the farm ponds. That's why there are some vegetables surrounding the farm ponds, they are growing. So evaporation will be reduced through that. So these are the local methods, and they are evolving lot of techniques, small techniques it may be, but all techniques and all our efforts are making farmers more comfortable and increasing his income up to 60-70% more than whatever he was getting in the previous days before construction of farmers. Thank you.
The responsibility of the farmers and the accountability of the NGO
activities.
So the NGO staff themselves started taking on responsibilities. As a result, they should bring down the cost of the cost of doing everything.
It's a very good lesson for all of us.
And not only just for the ponds, they added many things so that the farmer's income really goes up. This is another very good lesson for our thank you, Dr. Bishnu.
Good afternoon. Yeah. I am from BAIF Development Research Foundation. BAIF is working in 17 states, covering around 176,000 villages. And yearly we are covering around 5.6 million villages. Coming to the climate change topic, climate change is an emerging challenge to the livelihoods, food security, and also overall well-being of the rural communities. And the majority of the population is dependent on climate-sensitive sectors, resources like agriculture, forest, soil and water. So, in order to implement climate smart livelihood activities, we have designed some projects which are supported by some corporates, which are also implemented on their own. It is not that the money is there, only the project will be implemented. Even in some places, in the name of IKH, means Innovation and Knowledge Hub, we are implementing on our own, collecting all the money from the farmers. And in majority of the areas, we are implementing through corporates. So there are 5 points. One is improved community mobilization, collectively plan and undertake climate change adoption measures. Under this, majority of the areas, this agribusiness center, this wherever we have started the project, in each village, small and marginal farmers, about 60 to 100 farmers will be pulled together and one agribusiness center will be started and they will be asked to deposit some 1000 rupees in the beginning and also monthly 100 rupees. So together they will collectively plan what kind of inputs is required to them and what kind of measures required. So they collectively go to the government, concerned department and mobilize the resources whatever is required to them. That is number one. And number two, that is again building resilience through availability of water and also efficient use of water. So under this, in all the project, wherever we take land-based activities, earlier it was 10 into 10 into 3, now we have reduced it to 8 is to 12, 8 into 8 is to 12, based on the land availability, we are going for different size of the this thing, but one pot is necessary and also water can be held in the trenches. So that is one. And coming to the third one, adoption of climate smart agriculture technologies. So here what happens, the variety of the seeds, many universities, Krida, they have brought out many new varieties which are drought resistant, pest resistant. So those will be identified to those areas and those variety of seeds will be pulled up and through agribusiness center, those will be procured collectively and distributed to all the farmer in time. So that is one thing. And coming to the fourth one, the improved potential of livestock. So nowadays, farmers have stopped keeping the animals with them. So if you see the potential, our gear animal was giving just 3-4 liters earlier. Now you see the record, the gear itself is giving 67 liters. And many indigenous animals, sahiwal, all those animals are giving more than 25-30 liters. So once again we are motivating farmers at least to keep 1-2 animals with you so that this will be like integrated farming and the farming approach can be so sustainable one. So that is also we are promoting nowadays. And with that also we are giving very high-tech technologies. Now you see, you might have heard about sorted semen. In HF, Jersey, Gir, Sahiwal, farmers want that if they get female calf, that will be beneficial to them. If they get male calf, there is of no use. That will go to the slaughterhouse. So in order to arrest that, what we are doing is, we are producing only females in HF and Jersey. This year we are getting support from Milk Within the Gate Foundation for about 4 lakh animals. And coming year, we want to start this technology at our own central research station, Udikanchal, for all indigenous breeds. When it comes to the indigenous breeds, you see our Devani is there, Kilar is there. In Kilar, Devani, Ongole, farmer prefers male one because male fetches 25,000 to 30,000 at the age of 1 year. So there we are going for only production of males. Females will be reduced. So this is one kind. And the last one, fifth one is very important, like knowledge enhancement and also wider dissemination. So this has to happen through ICT, Information and Communication Technology. Now we have started call centers in 2-3 places where the registered farmers will be called once in 15 days and their problems will be noted down and the scientists will reply to their questions and also our field worker will visit to their areas. So these are the few very new technologies which we are adopting in BAIF. For you may call it as a agriculture, climate smart technology or sustainable agriculture or modern village concept, whatever the name you call, it is for the farming future. Thank you.
Thank you, Shivarudrappa. It's a very informative question. And we all know that we live in an integrated farming and working in integrated view of the farming. And we have seen we have seen here even in Yerubli how in 1 acre you can do sustainable agriculture with life as demonstrated. So I think there is a lot to learn from you for everybody. Yeah. Now I move to Balakrishnan. So now I request Bala to talk about Vrutti's work in farming and what they are doing in the farm.
Thank you, sir. I talk about what currently we are doing and also the topic is about future of farming. I think we all know very recently also it is about the UK, the Farmers Union has actually written an article about only like 60 more harvests left in the world. Yeah, because their quality of soil is much better than our Indian soils. They themselves, they are saying it is only 60 harvests left. Yeah. Then you can see the future of the farming, how it is going to be. And also, we know that recently the water, everyone is talking about water. India is going to be declared as a water-scared country in another 9 years or so. Yeah, that's the statistics is actually saying. Yeah. I think that's where Vrutti is past about 7-8 years, we are working on a model where we are trying to address all these issues. Yeah. How do we make the farmer as an entrepreneur? We are not like only as a working, like looking at the science angle, or we looked at in the morning someone saying also pride, because the farmers are doing as a pride. Yeah, but the reason, the trend also, there are a lot of suicides in the country. Yeah, we all know. And also the people are leaving job. When we actually work with the farmers, when we ask each of the farmers close eyes, we will also close eyes. Like we close eyes, you like kind of put up your hand. How many of you, your children wanted to continue in agriculture? Yeah, none of them actually like putting their hands up, like telling that their children wanted to continue in agriculture. Yeah, we all know the issues in agriculture. I don't need to repeat what kind of issues farmers are facing as we are discussing about climate change, as we are discussing about elections and the knowledge related inputs to the farming community, especially for the smaller marginal holders. And also reaching on time inputs. Still we are seeing that fights in the PACS, primary agriculture property societies, where they need to stand in the long queue for fertilizer, seeds, yeah. And also water, and also electricity, and also natural resources, which is not available for the farming community. We are working on a model called threefold. Is making farmers wealthy, resilient and responsible farmers. We work with the farmers about 10-year journey. We have done it in about 3 places. Based on that only this model we have actually finalized, and then we are working with partners like Social Venture Partners and Mindtree. Yeah. They support us in developing this model.
Now, the interventions are related to good agriculture practices, working with the farmers, what they currently doing, how do we help them to do it in the right way, as like Bhat was mentioning about SRI techniques. Yeah. We are not changing the crop currently because we wanted to build a trust among the farmers, what they do currently, how do we build trust, and then what they are doing, how do we make them do it better. That itself helps them to reduce cost, yeah, and reduce, increase their margin. That's what we are doing here. And also we help them to do locally kind of produce inputs, which is the two enterprises, which we all know we promote for our activities, like vermicompost or biopesticide units, all these are meme-based pesticide units, all that we promote, local enterprises, which also helps the empowerment generation and also dependency on the external inputs, it also helps to reduce the cost and also in terms of the climate change as well. And the third, we also, all these are good, but how do we make it sustainable? We also work on the institution model, where we all know in the country, farmers collective, and we all know in the country that Dr. Kumian has set up the Amul. How do we build those kind of institutions for the farmers? That's where we also build the farmers collective. Through that, we help them to bulk buying of inputs, which is required, and on time, and the quality, which actually helps them to do it better. And we also do it at the market level, not largely on the trading, where we help them currently also in Kulkarni, we are doing about 25 crores. That's on SRDS. We have actually helped farmers to sell about 25 crores of tuta. Yeah. It's about each farmer hand, we have additional income, we have contributed about 20,000 rupees. Yeah. This is what we are actually, and then also valuation marketing. We are trying to help farmers to also value added product, like from tur to tur dal, green gram to green, like moong dals, and also like we have poppers and millet rices, all these we are working on. But in the long run, we are actually going to make like Amul. We will be having a market making company where these farmers, we work in 6 states, where all these farmers own a company, the single brand, and we will be selling in the market. If you do all this, what is the impact we are creating? Yeah. We work in a 10-year journey. About 10 years, 8,000 farmers. We work in a cluster where we reach up to 10,000 farmers. Like 8,000 farmers, their income will be threefold. If somebody's income is about 15,000, then we make them like 45,000 in the end of 10th year, their income will be. Yeah. That's the journey in which we have proved it in 3 locations we have done it. One in Budni in Madhya Pradesh, one we have done it in Thirunamalai in Tamil Nadu. And also in Kulkarni. These are possible through an ecosystem approach where you work on multiple interventions, you work on good agriculture practices, and one of the important components I wish to share with you on that, appropriate finance. Because we all know that finance is not actually reached to the farmers. But the KCC, Vijay sir also knows because he worked in the banking industry, but it was not reached to small and marginal farmers. We all know why. Because they don't have a proper land records, because it's maybe in their father name or in their grandfather name, yeah, still lands are not divided. Then we are now partnering with a foundation called IDF, Initiative for Development Foundation. We are creating a JLGs, and then that avoids the collateral or the land records. Then farmers are able to get a KCC credit card. Then they are able to get a lowest interest rate for farming. And also through other, like you know in the country, there are many NBFCs have come up to provide loans to farmers, like you know, NAPKISANS, NABARD Financial Services, you know, Ananya Finance, like these organizations, we collaborate and work with them and provide working capital loans to farmers collectives. We are currently working in this model about 32,500 farmers in about 6 states. By 2026, we will be reaching about 5 lakhs farmers. In this journey, we are like funded by like I think Crazy Farmer Initiative. We have like Godrej Agrovet, we have like Social Venture Partners, we have like Lincoln Bay, we have like Lincoln, these, and also like Small Farmers Agribusiness Consortium and NABARD. These organizations have funded us. We are in the journey of making change in the lives of farmers. Thank you.
Thank you, Bala. So, just like Dr. Rudrappa said, how do you integrate services to the farmer? Vrutti has also demonstrated that how do you bring multiple service providers to the farmers.
Agriculture extension is also one area probably.
Yes, yeah.
You can speak a little bit about that.
Yeah, as the good agriculture practices, we have about for about 150 farmers, we have agribusiness accelerators. Every 150 farmers, we have agribusiness accelerator. He or she will be having a tab, which is the beta version already we have launched. It is partnership with Mindtree. We have an app called I Got Crops. In that, we actually provide stage-wise, crop stage-wise advisory services to the farming community. In every location that we work. In each location, we actually prioritize about three commodities through which we actually give them advisory, like pre-production, production, and the post-production. Yeah. And also, in that technology, we are able to also aggregate their input requirements as well. Yeah. The FPO comes to know what is the input requirement from the farmer side. That will help us to easily kind of negotiate with the buyers, like suppliers. This is what we are doing in the
market. I got crops.
Interestingly, you know, a lot of technology companies, a lot of new field of financial institutions are coming to work in this sector, which is a very positive signal. I think, many of we keep on discussing that why a farmer gets a loan, then everything is not reliable. You are saying that I'll give you a 10,000 rupee crop loan and you should give me 10,000 with whatever rate interest, whether it's 3% or 1% or 4%. Then there's complete uncertainty about crop itself. So why there are no angel investors or venture capitalists in agriculture? So a lot of new thinking is actually emerging that how to fund agriculture and what are the financial models for agriculture. I'm happy that many new things are emerging here. And now I request Sikandar to tell about his work and what he is really contributing to the farmers and their teams.
Hello, my name is Sikandar. Our organization name is Sankalpa Society. So we are working in rainwater harvesting through borewell recharges. You know that the farmers are digging the boreholes, take the groundwater from their ground, and use the agriculture purpose and horticulture and whatever. So nowadays the last 30-35 years we are digging the boreholes and take the water. Now the groundwater goes down around 1,500 feet. You can see in Bangalore almost dried up, and Kolar and Malur area they are taking above 1,000 feet. So here in Bangalore and Hubli and Dharwad, minimum they are 300 and 400 feet, and Gadar 600 and 700 feet. If you go and Bijapur, they are taking 800 to 1,500 feet. That also, it's very difficult that farmer will spend more and more money over 1 lakh, 1.5 lakh rupee. They spend on for taking the boreholes. Every year, that very good farmer, he dig a one boreholes, new boreholes. So what we started in 2009, it's very difficult to us also to convince the farmers. So this is the technology we are providing to recharge the boreholes. In the rainy season, summer season, you can implement, and rainy season, if you could recharge, then you can continuously can run into a borewell. Then none of the farmers will not believe. It's very difficult for me. I started in 2009. From 2009 to 2011, none of the farmers will not implement it. Then I discussed with Marvin sir. Sir, this is very difficult for me. I have the technology, but it's very difficult for me to farmer not convince. So that time I don't have any balance sheet. I don't have anything. So yes, I registered my NGO after my fellowship. And Marvin sir said, okay, what I can do, I will support you some of the amount. We can do that work grant model. I already worked with some grant model in earlier NGOs. I know that grant money is very difficult, because that time also we are before the fellowship we are thinking okay grant money is very good, but when I joined Deshpande Foundation program, okay, grant money is not working. It is very difficult. It is very short term. And I told the sirs, I am not working the grant money. Okay, I am thinking can grant. So 50%, 50% does not matter. So then I started the 50% from the farmer, 50% from the Deshpande Foundation amount. We spent some villages, we implemented almost two boreholes, take a time almost 7 months. almost 7 months, no one farmer will not come forward to implement, because they will 15,000 rupees they spend, 15,000 rupees Deshpande Foundation will give. That 15,000 rupees is very difficult to farmer contribution. Then three farmers, it's a very youngest farmer. So my technology where I am implementing, older farmer they are not ready to implement. The 90% of farmers are youngest farmer, they will come forward to implement our technology. Because they know TV, they know channels, they understand that new technology they are adapting easily. So my target is to talk with the youngest farmers. Then I implemented 3-4 wells in August. It's very good rainy season, that 2011. It's totally dried borewell, it's 15 years dried borewell. Only 1 month I reach almost 17 borewells. Then my target is that 15 borewells, but I reached 17 borewells that time, only 1 month. So this is how we are implemented the borewell feature. Then next year what I did, this year we can plant 100 borewells. So that time I talked with that time NABARD will support 2 times after this technology looked at that, and 2 times they supported, and Deshpande was again we can we collaborate with the Deshpande Foundation again. That time is 75-25. Then we have changed our model now, and some of the now is the technology spread over the almost 7 states in India. What we are doing now, we are charging the farmer will pay us, then including our consultancy also they will pay us. For one borewell recharge, we are charging 8,500 rupees for one borewell recharge. Then what we do, we are creating the from the farming community only. The one farmer called to from the somewhere in Maharashtra, what I will do? Okay, one farmer I will not come. We can 10 farmers you can gather, I will give the free to you one borewells. Then I can go and they will collect the 10 farmers, I can go and there, I implemented the 9 borewells. This borewell I give the free of them. So that model we are working now. Now we are this technology is we are starting in Kakadi also. In Kakadi I started doing 75-25, you know, model in the trans model in Kakadi. Like this we are started in industry also, we are working in industry. So what we thought sustainable, how the organization should sustain the next continuous, if you take this continuous run our organization, and what we are doing, we are supporting to the industry people and charging them almost their budget, and we take the 28% consultancy on budget in industry people and apartment also in Bangalore level and Hyderabad level and Mumbai level. I implemented Mumbai also and Hyderabad also. We are charging to 28% consultancy. If the apartment people give the all the program cost, they will give us to the our charges is 28% whole budget consultancy charges. This will run our organization for self-sustainability. Like this we are working in, we are already training that in Maharashtra, 3 people are training to implement the borewell recharge. They are also farmers, and some of the youngest farmers also. That's what we are doing.
Great work. I think not only you know what these institutions have achieved, the process of doing it is also I think very important. Because the lessons are, how did they reach there? How did they motivate people? How did they make them understand what they want to do is good for them? I think there are a lot of lessons to that. I think we are well, most of the people are not very really taken this. So now we can have a question answer session and. No, they are responding to your questions also. They are during that time it will be next. Anyone want to say
something? I think people have questions.
Yeah, okay. Good, so.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
What's the time required for this as in one borewell?
What is the
time required?
With the, yes, we are two technologies we are working on. One is old technology, it takes a long time, three days. It's take a sand, stone, and it's very difficult to now. Gold is available, but the sand is not available now. Now, what we reduce the cost from 15,000 rupees, there is another borewell recharge technology. There is only 1 day and finish that works. 1 day also.
And it's a
Yeah, it will be, the board technology is very good. This technology, earlier we have planned, that time is very available, the stone, sand and everything. That time we happily we are implemented. It will be like 3 days. Then now what we do, okay, difficult for sand problem. Now we are doing only pipeline, there is a online filtration like that. We put in that pipeline in the pond and connect into borewell. It is similar to soap which we are implementing. The first soap which we leave it that pipeline, it's a reversible water comes and goes in the water table that 4 years. It's very one day we can finish that.
Munda Sandbox would like to invite you. How many borewells do you want?
In Nalgunda last year we have implemented 5 borewells.
Suppose Nalgunda Sandbox would like to invite you for this next year. How many borewells do you want?
100 borewells.
Minimum.
100 borewells.
100?
You say 9?
The 9 is not a grand model. If you have 10 borewells you can give us, we will come and implement. It is 100% pay by from the farmers and our consultants. So 10 is okay.
10 is okay.
Yeah, 10
is one unit.
Myself, Vijay, I am the director of the MODERATOR. Myself, Chandrasekhar Chitlokar, I am a director on the board of an NGO project for rural welfare Kanpur. I am also director on the board of Bishnu Pune. I have drafted a report to planning commission. There is a village called Tamaswara near Varwa district in Kanpur where the risk to valley concept has been implemented. There are so many people have been talking about pond and farm pond and other methods. So the village has been so much benefited that you know they carried out the entire risk to valley concept of doing helping taking help from geological survey. And the entire stream was actually rightly caught. And even during summer time, the village has at least 50 feet water in the low beds. So the biggest advantage is that for every crore rupee of water money invested in water conservation, the incremental benefit to the farming community is anything between 3 crores to 5 crores over a 5-year period. So even if you take it on the lower side, or of 3 crores, for every 1 crore investment, the return over 5 years is 3 crore. So the incremental income is 60% on a per annum basis. The major reason for crop failure in the country today is mainly because of lack of water at the right time. You know, this is one particular method. A lot of people have talked about farm ponds. Let me elaborate another method. Pune, there has been beautiful model done in Kadakwasla where the dam capacity was earlier 4 TMC. Got reduced to 1.5 TMC because of the silt coming in over the last 30 years. Now, Vrutti has done entire distilling of Kadakwasla, 15 km back, and has removed 10 lakh tons of silt. The entire silt has been given free to the farmers, and the output of the farmers has actually doubled just by using the silt. So, you know, in terms of water conservation, in terms of, you know, silt is like better than urea. So, this particular methodology, I am also requested to look into this because India has more than 5,000 dams. If you are able to do good amount of distilling in those dams, a lot of water will be available for not only cities but also for villages, so that the problem of water, lack of water at the right time can be taken care of. So this is something which I wanted to share. My report is there with the planning commission. It has gone to Mr. Rakesh Khan, it has gone to Dr. Saraswati, it has given to Mr. also, it has been given to the Maharashtra CM also. So data is there, it's a proven fact that a large amount of investment in water conservation can benefit this country. My report goes to the extent saying that India can just achieve 10% GDP growth just by agriculture. Now if you take 7% as constant from industry and services, 3% incremental growth can only come from agriculture if there is proper investment in water conservation. Thank you very much.
I think any technology is always changing the behavior. It is, we have seen it is challenge. I think it is multiple kind of what we do is one is on the demonstration. How any technology, how it is going to benefit them, what is the kind of time reduction, cost reduction, how it is going to create impact. That is being done continuously with the farmers to increase the adoption rate. It is not 100% in any of the technologies. There is a challenge. It is we all working on it. It's based on only, we all know that farmers field school, it helps. It is where each one actually discuss, debate how this technology is different compared to what we are doing. Yeah. But there is a tremendous increase in adoption of technology like SRI, or any other whatever you say sustainable agriculture practices, these things are improving. This we do it through the demonstration and then training and then enrolling and then giving inputs also freely sometimes to also adopt those.
Well, if farmer wants to dig, this takes 60 hours. Then we think, okay, 60 hours is like good time, so good efficiency or not. Then we use only simple technology, telegram. So like every day our machine needs to report. So we can like monitor the machine, okay, which machine working 10 hours, 12 hours, 9 hours. And then we find very like interesting things like not having proper data. So that's like increasing the time, and then we monitor and taking daily decision on based on the machine working, and then you feel me like we increase 30% efficiency in terms of number or amount. So technology, I think, very good. It's only challenge whoever we like want to take it, it should be convinced. Like I want to take technology, I should convince. So it can be like very revolution in agriculture sector. We can increase the efficiency in terms of number, impact. And thank you.
Actually, I wanted to add to the question that was being asked about the adoption. You know, when in universities we teach adoption, we encourage people to think about three types of consumers. There are these early adopters who will jump on any new technology, whether it helps them or not. We see them with particularly with the buying of the phone everywhere. Then there are these, then you reach a point when there's this mass market, a large number of people see a point in doing something and they want to do it. And then there are those laggards who are, you know, who will do it absolutely because now everybody else has done. In your experiences, when you look at farmer profiles, who falls into that first category of early adopters? You talked about young people. Who is in that mass market and who are those last farmers?
What we experienced is with the technology is need-based. These farmers require the technology. Suppose 1 village is there, they are suffering from a drinking water problem, is there. So if you go there and talk about something else, their first priority is water. So before starting up, before taking up any technology, first we have to look at their priority. So it costs very, very minimum, about 1.5 lakh rupees. We can first fulfill their needs and then take them into confidence and then slowly show them elsewhere where we have already done some successful intervention. Then they'll easily agree to that. And they will also consider the credibility of the organization and also the fellow farmer who is already expressing their benefit out of these things. Then they will easily adopt. Otherwise, it takes time to implement.
Sometimes the technology the farmers are using, for example, if we send some messages to the one number, automatically the water pump will on. Sometimes another message won't go. So that pump will be running continuously and all water will be sucked. So sometimes the dangerous whatever they have faced, that's why suddenly they are not adapting to the technology. Another thing is some pesticides and insecticides they are using in the farming sector. Now all predatory species have gone. Lot of birds have died. So this biological method and microclimatic condition has been changed because of adoption of lot of different types of technology. That's why another thing is the breeding of improved variety of cows and all to the indigenous species of cows. So these are all because of that most of the indigenous cow varieties has eroded from the land. These are all the things. The while adopting new technology, we have to see whether it is biologically good or not, and it is friendly for the existing situation or the ecology.
Carry out the survey for the pond. You also do a total of topographical survey in order to find out how the rainwater is actually going to come into the pond, because these are marginal farmers. Some of them may not have more than 2 to 4 acres. So, is the catchment area sufficient or do you use the
Just within the even in rainy season, some stream will come. So we will sometime we will divert the stream and we will store the water, and excess water will be diverted to the next farm pond. So sometime we will exploit the seepage water efficiently. So we will take the confidence of local elders where we can have spring water, where we can construct the farm pond. These are all matters will be considered during construction of the farm pond. And we also construct small trenches type of things in the wetland, that's a highland areas. And we also construct some water arresting structures there also.
Who bears the cost of that?
So all bear by the farmers only. We focus on individual farmers or 2-3 households together they can construct. But we provide only machines. They have to pay design and their maintenance, everything. From the farmer only they have to pay.
Question for Mr. Sikandar, do you measure the yield rate of the borewells after the rainwater comes?
Some places we are using usually we are not using that measuring farmer community, because they know that they are telling that okay, before our borewell is only 1.5 inches, now we are taking 3 inches. They are saying it, the course also.
So what he will do is, he will construct a farm pond. So each farm pond water holding capacity is around 4 lakh liter. So he will check how much time that the farm pond has been filled and it has gone to the tube wells. So it is 3 times he can know that total around 12 lakh liter has been infiltrated to the tube wells. That he will check.
There is a problem there. You see, aquifers are shared by a lot of other underground aquifers underground.
Yeah.
Whatever you get out may not be recovered. So what I mean by yield rate is, you know, the recovery rate of these wells.
Yeah, recovery, exact measurement of recovery rate is not possible. Sometime this tube well will be infiltrated water will go to the another downwards tube well will be recharged.
Yeah.
That chances is very high.
That's why we are doing at least
in an adjacent borewells, it will be recharging, and that's why all borewell will be recharged. If one or two in a particular geography, one tube well will be recharged, we can't say 100% success in getting back that one.
Okay, thank you.
Various projects, NABARD, IWMP, and NAUPRA, we have created a lot of farm ponds in almost all the water sets. Starting from 10% contribution, then 25% contribution, then 50% contribution. There are examples, 100% in a village, in the surrounding some of the area, depending upon the need, in a village more than 360 farm ponds, it is totally 100% contribution people have taken up. We have made it only facilitated to take up this farm pond activities. Where my point here is this, it is not uniform everywhere. The farm pond depends, the impact of the farm pond depends, varies from the topography, soil type, crops that they are cultivating, everything is matters. In some area it is not at all became because that is not relevant.
So very good question. Like in foundation we have one model, farmer need to pay all operational costs. Like in Navalgun, land holding is higher, so the same size 100 by 100, 12. But he need to pay all operational costs. So last year we replicated this model in Telangana, and the farmer land holding is lesser. So we reduce the size, but all costs take care by the farmer. So we are very clear, farmers should be serviced if your service makes so much value for him. Because our farm board, even 50 by 50, 10 feet in Telangana city fair, he or she can easily grow to grow. So that's why person can easily pay. So you should, as our understanding as a DF, so you should be clear about your model. You should not confuse. If your message is simple, so farmer take is faster. So our all team know, either it's field level or middle level or senior level, what need to done. So you no need to spend your money on like convincing your people or operational cost. So I think you can reduce size and process should be same for everywhere. Or it's working now, and this year we would like to have same number in Nalgonda. We already like 200 people waiting for it. City paid around 500, and here already 1000 people waiting for having power phone for same course. So that's the indicator. If your service can make so much value for someone, so he or she will pay for it. Thank you.
I wanted to ask Vrutti. So you told you are working on tour in Gulbarga district. So for seed and other thing, they input cost more. At the same amount, they putting money for pesticide and to control the pesticide diseases. Is there any user-friendly technology, you called plant-based pesticide? Because landholding is more. They put the tour in 100 acre, 50 acre, 80 acre. So at that time, how user-friendly technology to control the pesticide diseases? Because these modern methods are very easy, but at the same time, it is too hazardous to control that, to break down that chain of the technology, modern technology. Is there user-friendly plant-based pesticides, disease control mechanism is there? Please tell me.
Yeah, so it is, all of us, we know that all these biopesticides are not a killer. We need farmers to adopt these technologies. We have a cow urine-based biopesticide, use of custard apple leaf, which is have a lot of this bitterness, those leaves we actually mix it, and then it has been successful. We have tried it, yeah, there is no doubt. But those things are this taking challenge. But we have also like partnered with like PCA, and also we have partnered with like barracks. They have like the sticky traps and the thermal traps. These are also just helping to reducing the pesticide, like sprays, number of sprays. If they are spraying about 4 sprays, you can reduce it to 2 sprays, yeah, or if a single sprays, we can actually do. These two ways we are actually making farmers to change. And we don't know, we are not also working with these huge landholding farmers, you know, because the very large, some of the farmers are with us in Gulbarga is about 10 to 15 acres. Yeah. Rest of 80% of them are less than 5 acres farmers.
To make pesticides stick better to hydrophobic plants. So the idea is that it's sort of a two nozzle type of a system where the pesticide with adjuvant coming from one nozzle is positively charged, and what's coming from the other nozzle is negatively charged. And it's angled such that when it hits the plant, it stays there for a while, so the absorption is better. And the soil contamination is lower because the bouncing off is smaller. So this we now have shown in the lab, and the productization is sort of the next step, but we are quite excited about it. In fact, recently the student who is working on it won the World Technology Prize in California, and is a contestant in the finals for Leonardo DiCaprio. So we were very excited about that.
Our knowledge transfers among the farmers. So as you all were new in your field, what communication channels did you use to approach your farmers? And what communication channels are you using now once the technology is proven to communicate with other farmers?
I am the Chief Operating Officer of Jharkhand State Livelihood Promotion Society. It is a part of Department of Rural Development, Government of Jharkhand. As you know, Jharkhand is the one of the poorest state of India, from the bottom of three states we are below that. And 28% of our population are tribal, and very poor, marginal people are there. and we are implementing many rural development schemes, but major scheme is National Rural Livelihood Mission. Recently that scheme name has little bit changed, that is called Dindayal Upadhyaya Antyodaya Yojana DANRLM, and our mission is to help poor people, the poorest of people, to come out of poverty. And in NRLM we believe that every poor has the innate capability, also interest, desire to come out of poverty, and it needs a right kind of environment, professional support and institutional building to come out of poverty. On the basis of these principles we are working on, we are focusing on the poor, building their institutions. In NRLM we have four components. One component is called institutional building, means funding of women self-help groups, then at a hundred level, then forming of village organization at village level, forming of cluster level organization at cluster level, farmers organizations, then we go for financial inclusion, like promoting saving, credit, insurance, and then bank linkages with the group. Then we also promote livelihoods, various type of focusing on agriculture and animal husbandry. And fourth component is our entitlement. Government entitlement, there are lots of entitlement government provide to people, but they are not able to get, like their medical card, social security pensions, then PDS. So we help those people to get those kind of things. Also another component that we call social development, the marginalized people, the excluded people who are not coming to SHG for the foundation. So we are working on that, and presently we are working all 24 districts, 120 blocks out of 216 blocks, and till now we have formed 55,000 SHGs, and there is around 5,75,000 family, and we are doing livelihood with 2.5 lakh family. And our model is SHG is not being formed by a government official or an NGO. We are doing all CRP model, means that community resource person. In the year 2012, we are taking help of Andhra Pradesh and Bihar. The CRP means the experienced SHG members, those who have completed 5 or 10 years of being a member of SHG, they are coming to Jharkhand in a group of 5 and staying in a particular village and forming the SHGs. For the livelihood also, we are called livelihood CRP, they also go to village and stay there and work with people and promote the livelihood. Even though still today we are taking help from the Telangana and Andhra Pradesh, but we have promoted more than 2000 CRPs in Jharkhand who are promoting SHGs, livelihood, and we call different livelihood CRP, like Ajivika Pashu Shakti, means those women SHG members being trained in animal husbandry and providing support to animal husband, like we go for mainly small ruminants, means goat, backward quality and dog care. So those Ajivika Pashu Shakti is one of the member of SHG, but we rigorously trained in the management, feed and minor medicine and care, so that they extend looking at the extension of service for the poor. For the technology, I am coming to your question. We have many partnerships with many NGOs, many technical international agencies. One of the agency we call, you may be find out in the net, that is called Digital Green. It's promoted by the Microsoft, and Mr. Gandhi is promoted, one of the, I'm forgetting his first name, the title is Gandhi. Tiki Gandhi, and he is, we have a very collaboration with them, and they called video CRPs, means group of CRP, they shoot the video. And we are promoting non-chemical, non-pesticide agriculture, means we are treating the seed with the GMO fruit and the organic methods, and also do not apply chemicals for the pesticide, like you use pheromone traps, we use that organism, so that for the control of pests. And that video technology is one of the very good extensive method, and that video is prepared by the local CRP, preparing this protecting crop or doing some nursery or this agriculture operation, and that video being displayed the villages, or the neighboring villages, and in the evening, and there is a question answer session during this video. So So farmers are adapting those methods because that local practice and being sued by the local person and being explained by the local person. So they feel that this can be adopted because high technology from coming from outsider may not be accepted. They will tell that that is possible in Maharashtra but not possible in Jharkhand. So that with that kind of thing.
Then they have built institutions and using those institutions, many of us can implement projects in agriculture. After monitoring their impact, we want to scale up our work in agriculture also. We need to have collaboration government. And National Livelihood Mission is one such institution which has created a platform for millions of people in their respective states. So it's a great platform to collaborate with them and work.
European country. So, but we ensure the quality. So we look person who can help us. So because as madam said, like we don't have much SSD, but around like 200 SSD plus we have, and we live with KVGB, and I am very proud to say our like 100% recovery, they paid all. So because 2 years we mentor them. So we live with papaya. Now we are in the stage somehow like 5% or 10% is not taken data, so produce going to waste. So we can have something which can help farmer or something we can do. So still we did not started our thought. We work as a facilitator and let's bring lot of clients who have expertise on different like you have post harvest technology. So we can have like opportunity and start working something. Thank you.
One of them is a data center idea, another one is a student team working on it. There's a team that is developing these smaller cold storage type of units that are made of phase change material. So they will, you know, they are taken to a certain temperature and then they cool down. You can put your produce in it and for a few hours, like 24 hours, they will be cold. So you can reach the next your destination, and they designed it such that our trucks can take multiple of such units. So they are designed for our local Tata trucks, for example. So that's one technology that seems promising. They're still going through that prototype. The other one, which could be really a revolution, but it needs a lot of work, and that's going on in the labs. Is this metal organic frameworks type of technology? The idea there is that can we make cooling, can we make air conditioning that doesn't require electricity? So it's sort of the based on the material's ability to absorb heat. You can sort of begin to make smaller chambers that will remain cool regardless of in a passive way. This would be really revolutionary. Currently, that material can only be made in a petri dish size. So now, if you want to make a room out of it, you have to do that level of experimentation. That's the other question I'm saying.
We have in Farming for the Future. Is not only convincing the farmers to take up the technology, but it's also creating and sustaining our teams. And actually, that's a question I'd like to throw open to you folks who obviously do create and sustain a good team. What advice do you have in relation to that? A couple of tips in relation to that would be really great. Thank you.
Team value or leader should be taking care, the person should find his or her vision financially or something different. So you should take care his expectation, and you should not demotivate your vision. You should be very clear if you want to reach this thing, and you, if you reach, have an incentive or regular mentoring for them. And we've been having 200 people team in this year. So this is the only tip where we can keep. Like my, I'm working last 5 years with Deshpande Foundation. I have 80% will be staff who regularly last 5 years working with me, and they change, they start as a community staff like supervisor and taking care of one cluster. So we should be more open to give chance for second generation or new people. So that's, I think, best way to mentor or keep team motivated and longer time. Thank you.
So everywhere the retention is a problem, attrition is more. But one thing is that our senior people, so now what we adopted is whenever we recruit, we are keeping them with our senior people for about 6 months. And then clear cut their aspirations are understood. And then trying, but still the problem is there. But to a large extent we have eroded.
Once if you did the TCP, the second year will be closing. Farmers themselves are taking it out, or is there any strategy which you are working through farmer groups or any strategy?
CLP is not developed, what to only rent. So we are not doing the certification every year.
So then it is not going to hold the water?
No, it will hold water. So when the tree is grown up, then the basin will be prepared.
For the tree, you are preparing the basin?
Yeah, that
or
basin.
Or the burn?
Yes. Burn and after we take up the plantation in trenches. Only some water trees, very light water trees, and this. So another matter will be taken up on the buds. The forested trees are planted in the trenches only. Okay, I think I will